If people in the States, if kids in the States would just kind of like pay homage and just really pay attention to, you know, music and how it came from, they would have a way bigger appreciation for, you know, the guys who paved the way. You know what I mean?
Absolutely. That voice right there is the voice of our guest today. We're celebrating him. To me, he's a hip-hop pillar. I think DJ Eclipse will agree.
Absolutely.
Okay. We're going to be celebrating today. It's out right now, his new project, Smack Pack Volume 12.
Woo! Yes, yes.
But Tracy, I got to say, man, that Jay-Z album, Reasonable Doubt, was one of my favorite albums of all time.
Yep.
Yes.
That song we just played, Feeling It, was produced by this amazing producer who's with us right now. He worked on In My Lifetime, Hard Knock Life. He's done all these different things. He's worked with Lil' Kim. He's worked with Fat Joe. He's worked with Razzcast. He's worked with Locksmith. He's worked with Foxy Brown. He's worked with Joel Ortiz.
Woo!
I mean, the list goes on and on and on, and there's a reason why it goes on, Eclipse, because what he brings to the game is incomparable to anybody else who's attempted to do what he does. And he's a pillar because he established himself early in the game. I was there when it happened.
MC Roots.
I was there when it happened. MC Roots, right?
MC Roots.
He could bust a 16 anytime you wanted to do it.
Uh-oh.
I know he keep it in his pocket. Please welcome him back. We got a hip-hop legend with us, the one and only Ski Beatz.
Woo!
Is here.
What's up, y'all? How y'all doing? Y'all
What's
good?
Up?
Yes.
Yo,
what's up?
Ski called, you know, we was talking, and Ski was like, yo, I got a new project coming out, Smack Pack Volume 12.
Yeah.
And you're doing a challenge with this, too. And I was explaining to Mike Muse what the Smack Pack is.
Well, I mean, the Smack Pack, let me tell you how it started.
Okay.
It started during the pandemic. I had broke out the SP-1200. Remember the SP-1200?
The drum sequencer?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying?
But that's the proper terminology?
Or? Drum machine.
Drum machine. Okay, I went deep.
You know what I mean? I broke it out. You know, it's the pandemic. We ain't going nowhere. We're in the house. So
right.
I broke out the SP-1200. I made a beat. And I was having fun. You know, I haven't used the 1200 for years. So on my Instagram post, I say, hey, man, I just made a beat with the 1200. You only get 10 seconds of sampling time. Shit's liberating. I bet y'all can't do it. The next morning, my DM was full of videos of kids, 10-second challenge. And they's like, yo, I can do this. You know what I'm saying?
Uh-huh.
Mad videos. So I start posting the videos on my page. And, you know, and after that, it just took off. People was just, you know, feeling the vibe, feeling the energy. And I saw how producers was learning new producers and connecting. It was like a network.
Right.
It was like a community. And I said, you know what? This is kind of dope. This is positive. So I basically gave my page to my community.
Wow.
Yeah, wow, man. Ski Beatz. So it started from?
The 10-second challenge. Then it morphed into the Smack Pack. So every month what I do, I get a gang of producers to help me design the pack, create the sounds. I get rappers. Like this month we got Stiles P. He sent me a verse. And it's the producer's job to create a dope track with the sounds in the pack and the verse. And, you know, they put it on their IG. They tag me in it, and I post it up. I post it if it's bad or if it's good, I'm posting it.
You get to post it.
Everybody get posted.
That's fire.
So, Mike, you get it, what a pack is?
I got it.
Okay, so, all right. So how many sounds are included in the pack?
Man, we don't give you, like, the little 200 megabyte packs. We give you, like, the 4 gigs.
Oof. Oh, shit.
Taking this dead serious.
4 gigs?
You know what I'm saying? Like every month it's like 4 gigs of just hot shit. You know what I'm saying? And it's dope because I'm exposing new sound designers, I'm exposing new artists, and you know, artists that's in the game, and all these kids are just creating incredible music. And it's definitely inspiring me to create. You know what I mean?
I love it. So if you're a creative and you want to know how to put music together, not just rap music, you can use these sounds for all music, right?
Oh, yeah, yeah. The sounds vary. You can use it for anything.
And even if you're a radio show producer, if you're a TV producer,
a film
producer, these sounds are applicable. If you want to get one of these packs, how do people get the Smack Pack?
Easy. Just follow me on IG, Ski Beatz, SKIBEATZ on Instagram. The link is in my bio.
But do folks have to license it from you? Like, say if somebody, I don't know, from Marvel puts together a soundtrack.
Oh, yeah. As soon as you get the pack, you're going to see the little readme file saying, these sounds are strictly for this challenge, but if you want to use it for something else, you got to get in touch with us.
Okay. Yep. Mm. Okay, which makes sense, right?
Mm. Yeah, of course.
Now, it started off with the SP-12, right?
Uh-huh.
Okay. What popular songs did you make with that drum machine?
Ah, man, you know, Dead Prez.
Never stop. Wait, hold up, man. Wow. Don't just throw. He just threw it. As he named them, maybe you might want
to
throw them
all right, back. Back to that Reasonable Doubt bag.
He said Dead Prez.
Oh, yeah, all the Reasonable Doubt.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, with Jay-Z. All right.
96, wow. Baby.
Most of Camp Low. Not Lucchini.
Not Lucchini?
Yeah, okay. I made Lucchini on the 3000, but most of Camp Low. Bahamadia. You know.
Wait, hold up. Bahamadia. Let me say the Ski Beatz. When you say certain words like the SB-12 or the 3000, you got to qualify the MPC.
The MPC 3000,
which is a
drum machine.
Okay, there you go.
And it's really infamous because Dilla used that one.
Jay Dilla.
Mm-hmm. Jay Dilla, yeah.
Out of Rest in Power.
Always.
Rest in Power. Out of Detroit. And then Jay Dilla was known for just creating his own type of drum signatures and patterns and the whole nine, right?
He was off the grid. He was crazy.
So the SB-12 is where you made your most money?
Definitely. Mm. And you know what? My mom, she knew I wanted that drum machine, so she laid it away for me. And I told my mom, I said, look, because I was in college at the time, and I wasn't really doing shit in college. I'm like, Mom, save your money, because I don't want to do this. I want to make music. And my mom was 100% in my corner. And she said, you know what? If I get you this thing, you got to make it work. So she got it for me. She laid it away. It took a minute. She got it. Came to the crib. I kind of stopped. I ain't telling nobody to drop out of college, but that's what I did. You know what I mean?
You did.
And it worked for me, bro.
So now, was that your first thing, or what were you using when you were doing the Busy Boy stuff and all that?
I was rapping in the Busy Boy.
You didn't do any production in the Busy Boy, just rapping?
No. Okay. Yeah, but the guy who produced Rhythm Fanatic, he had the SB-1200. That's why I wanted it. He taught me how to use the SB-1200.
Okay. Hmm. He taught you how to use it, okay.
Yeah,
now, which tool was your biggest investment, came at the highest cost?
Wow. I done been through so much stuff since then, but SP-1200, that's it.
Yeah.
Because, you know, because that set everything off. I was able to pay my mom back, and it definitely helped me start a career.
How much did it go for?
Back then, I think it's
2000. Was it 2000?
Like $2,000.
Yeah.
So I'm curious about that story you just told. It's not like you took you bet on yourself.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Totally.
Right? What was it that made you that burning urge to bet on yourself to say, I can take this risk, jump out the window, and then land on Reasonable Doubt?
Because it was
right.
Yo, dude, it was no doubt in my mind that I could not do it. I always knew I could do it. I said, if I had this and had that, I could do it. I moved to New York. Now, I'm originally from North Carolina. I moved to New York with my partner at the time. I had $20. He was from New York. I lived with him and his mom for like a year.
Wow.
And my mom was like, yo, you ain't got no money. You're going to go to New York. You don't know nothing about New York. What are you doing? Boom, boom, boom. But I said, yo, I know I can make it. You know what I'm saying? I just know I could do it. Like, it was nothing telling me, like, yo, you tripping, dude. It was just like, go. Hmm. And I just left and it started happening.
No reasonable doubt, huh?
Stupid. I knew
that was coming.
I saw a twinkle in your eye.
Yeah, but you know, as soon as he said it, I was on it. But I think we've all been, like, if you came up in this era of DJ Eclipse, Ski Beatz, myself, back then you had more naysayers than you had anything else.
Mm. Yeah, for
so
sure.
Many people. I can't tell you how many times I was told I would never do well in radio.
That's crazy.
That's crazy.
That sounds bizarre.
Ain't that crazy?
That's super crazy.
When me and King Tech first started putting out music, you guys, you're never going to make a record worth anything, a song worth anything.
Mm. Wow.
And we did well regionally,
yeah.
And did it anyway. Mm-hmm. What was some of the biggest things said to you by naysayers? I'm curious.
Oh, man, I remember being at this high school, and I was outside talking about, yeah, man, I'm a rap. I'm going to do this and do that. And this one kid said, you ain't going to ever be nothing. And that was the battery. He didn't know he put the battery in my back.
What's his name?
His name was Steve.
Steve!
Damn loser!
You, Steve. Steve was like, yo, you shut up. You ain't going to do nothing. After that, that's a word.
Oh, my gosh.
What about you, Eclipse?
I mean, for me, even more so, I mean, you know, being white, trying to get into hip-hop, you know, back then, you know, the mid-80s, and it was like... It was a mission, you know what I'm saying? So pretty much everyone was looking at me like, yeah, whatever, you know what I'm saying? You're only getting attention because you're white, you know? And it's just like, you know, so I had to go through all that, you know? And but I think just when you look at people such as Ski coming from North Carolina, I mean, I came back up north from South Carolina. Look at Premier coming from Texas. There's a lot of people that we were all inspired by what was going on here, and it was our dream. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, if you put your time and effort and energy and you made that trip and you know what I'm saying? It's like, you see, it can happen. You know what I'm saying? People definitely made careers out of their dreams.
Mm-hmm. But you were a person who was white that truly immersed yourself in a culture and with some humility, learned about it, respected it, and paid, you honored it up until this point. Where there are others who I think use it, you know.
Oh, absolutely.
They stand next to it in public, but behind closed doors, they don't love it. Mm. They don't fully invest in it.
Right.
And they don't care what happens to those who help create it.
Black or white.
Black or white.
Yes,
so
absolutely.
It's a difference when you say what you went through than what I've seen other folks who come in. They get excited. They love what it looks like.
Right.
They want to be a part of it. They want to dress the part.
Right.
I even want to sing the lyrics. I even want to say nigga because it's in the lyrics, right? You know, and then if something happens in regards to the people outside of a record, or if we see what's going on inside of our community, of the culture that created this culture, they have no invested interest.
Absolutely. And you got to keep in mind, the era we come from, there wasn't anything to aspire to. It wasn't like there was Jay-Z's and 50 Cent's and, you know, Eminem's for that matter, that you were like, oh, I want to be at that level. We were just seeing it like more like people, you know, breaking in the background on some commercials or, you know, seeing an MC. It wasn't like there was, it wasn't like we were doing it because we wanted to get rich. Yeah. Mm. It was because it drew us in.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? It's like we could just relate to, for me, it was like, you know, I tried my hand at everything. I tried to write graph, I tried to write some rhymes, but DJing was the thing that just called me in. And I was like, that's exactly what I wanted to do. So I started buying records before I even had equipment. You know, I was just playing records on my mom's turntable. And,
wow.
You know, everything else came along.
That's dope. DJ Eclipse right there.
So on the flip end, I'll start with you, Ski, and then we can go to you, Eclipse. Who do you guys remember as your first champion outside of a family member, outside of your mom? Mm. On the opposite end of Steve.
Oh, wow. So many people. The first person, besides my mom, that was like, yo, you can do this?
Mm-hmm.
There's so many people. I'm going to say my best friend, Don Brown. He definitely was supporting. He was definitely in the corner. He was like, yo, dude, you're a genius. Keep it going. So big shout out to Don, man. He told me I could do it. You know what I'm saying?
Don got the last name. Steve didn't get the last name.
Right, you see? It's different. Levels of importance.
Eclipse, what about you, Eclipse?
I can't say for sure like anyone that was like the battery, but the dudes I always credit up in Providence, Rhode Island, there's this crew called Magical Four, and the DJ was DJ Bucket. You might know Buck.
Ooh, I know Buck.
Yeah, so Buck, I always just watched what he was doing. And then also my man Al Shell, who was an MC in the group but also could DJ. I got cool with them because I was going to school with them, and I would just watch everything they did. They go to USA Skating Rink, perform, I'd watch. They go to Living Room, perform, I'd watch. And I just would just learn and study everything they did. I'd go over to Al's house, he'd cut up for me, and I would just sit there and just study, and I'd watch what to do. So they were my biggest inspiration of me being like, okay, this is the closest thing I have to me here in Providence that I can see what's going on, and that inspired me, and that was my battery to keep going. So I credit them for that.
You know, love it.
Eclipse, I love it, man. Hey, Ski, since I got you here, man, play that Feeling It again. I just kind of want to walk through what happened this day when this was going on. You, Jay-Z, what's the young lady on the hook name? Becca?
Mecca.
Yep. You, Jay-Z, Mecca. Citizens, you know this song. If you're hip, if you know this culture, you know this song, right? And we got the producer of it. It's Feeling It by Jay-Z. And we got Ski Beatz. You got any of this in your?
I put the computer away. Let me pull the computer back out. I'll try to get it out by the time the song ends.
Okay, don't worry. We got the producer right here. 9-6.
I'm feeling it. Feel the passion. I'm feeling it. Feel the legs pushing up on the stage.
I'm feeling it. Crazy.
Feel the high that you get from the line. If you feel it, keep it real in the most.
Okay, stop right there. Stop. Jay came in and said, I keep it realer than most. Mm-hmm. And he kind of jumped in front of the beat to land on that one when he did that.
Right.
Where were you at? Were you sitting there at the booth, or were you at the board when he did? You know the verse? Yeah. What was going through your mind, Ski?
I was saying he was killing it. I'm like, oh, that's crazy. But you know, Feeling It was my song. That was a solo single song.
Okay. Oh, wow.
Yeah, I think it's online somewhere. I was rapping with my man Geechee Sway from Camp Lo.
Uh-huh. Yep.
I was starting work on my own little solo album. My homegirl Mecca, she came and sung the hook for me. I took it to Dame Crib. Jay was there, and he heard the record. And obviously, I mean, people know the story. He heard the record. He's like, yo, I need that record for my album. And I'm like, all right, take it. And it was my song.
It was your song. Jay was just hanging out at Dame House. Mm-hmm. What did y'all eat that day?
I don't know.
Yeah, what the bathroom look like?
So back then, did he write, or was that off the top?
No, he wasn't writing anything. Okay, I mean, I just, you know, he was in the studio. I saw him doing stuff, but he wasn't writing. But when he hit the booth, that came out.
How long did it take for him to complete the joint?
I can't remember.
Okay.
But it was quick. You know, as soon as you get in the booth, it ain't no takes. It's just that first take, he got it.
Did the song he made, what the version we hear, was it better than yours?
Oh yeah, yeah. But he took my flow though.
So that was your flow.
And he told me, he said, I'm gonna take that flow too.
Okay.
Nice.
And you said thank you.
He said cha-ching.
Cha-ching. So who was, as a producer, who was your biggest challenge as an MC?
To produce for?
Yeah.
Biggest challenge as an MC? That's a good question. It was always somebody that wasn't in the clique. Let's say like an AZ. You know what I'm saying? I had to do like a remix to the World Don't Stop.
Uh-huh.
It made the album, but it was a challenge because I didn't know anything about him. I didn't know his energy. Uh-huh. So it's always difficult for me to produce artists that I'm not like, you know, Cam Lo is easy because I know him. Jay-Z was easy because I was always around him.
Mm-hmm.
So I knew their vibe. So I knew exactly what to make. But when I'm working with outside artists, it's always like, okay, I don't know this person. I hope they like this. And I'm like, sometimes shit sticks, sometimes it don't. You know what I mean? But AZ was kind of the hardest because it was a remix.
It was a remix.
And that was my first time ever doing a remix for a song that was already done. So all I had was his vocals, and I had to kind of figure out what to do with it.
Did he like it?
He liked it. It made the album.
He liked the remix. Yeah. So when did you start, like, Locksmith and you teamed up to work? The Locksmith for Bay Area MC, we probably championed Locksmith more than any other show, I'm sure.
For sure.
Big facts.
You know, why Locksmith? What, how did that happen?
I heard him online. I saw him on YouTube rapping. And I'm like, yo, who is this dude? I want to fucking make a beat for him. And somehow I got in touch with him. And we didn't automatically connect when I got in touch with him. But when we finally did, I think he had made a song and said, Ski Beatz was supposed to make a beat for me, but he wasn't checking for me. And I heard that. I seen that video and heard that line. And I immediately got in touch with him. He came to New York. And as soon as I sat down with him, I already knew what to do. Because I knew his flow, I knew his energy, and we just connected quick, locked in. Lock is crazy.
Wait, play. You got a little bit. Let me play a little bit of this lock real quick, and then we'll come back with Ski Beatz.
I want to hear that, too.
Not a backpacker, underground mad rapper. Not a trapper or any artist of that stature. Ooh. The fact that I can rap's holding my stats backwards. I'ma dumb it down now so I can give you that after. The last chapter, an epilogue of ethanol. You ain't talking shit if you ain't talking about a check involved. Check it, dog faced. I'm all lace and ebony. The flow is AC. I spray D, so just let it be. Let it breathe. Let it seed your uncommonness. My wordplay will snatch your breath away, oncologist. Dope is an overdose, the flow we in is ODM, yo BM, whole fallopian is full of opium. Look at the boat we in, the shit's late. I got the best mixtape, and I ain't even did a mixtape. At this rate, I'm destined to be a legend. The bay is my prey, moment of silence for my brethren. World domination, we figured the combination. We picking the locks of the game, into the conversation. Yeah. You ain't gotta ask me, check the congregation. They was sleeping on dude, but now we got them saying,
what?
World domination, we figured the combination. We picking the locks of the game, into the conversation. You ain't gotta ask me, check the congregation.
Yo, and man, what was so dope about Locke is you just give him a beat break and he'll rap to that and kill it.
Bro, that dude is easy. Fat Joe came up here and said he's the dopest of this era.
That's right, he did.
Yeah. Come on, man. Joe's seen a lot of eras.
Man, I'm trying to get Locke to get in this smack pack, man. I need a verse from you, Locksmith. If you're listening, get at me. You know I'm trying to get at you, bro. I need a 16 for this next pack. I know the kids would go crazy with your vocals, man. It's Ski, man. Come on.
Come on, Locke.
I feel like Sway's making sure that happens in his phone.
So you go ahead, Tracy, while I go to...
Absolutely. I'm wondering, Ski, because we have a lot of upcoming producers who listen to our show who are part of our citizenship. How do you decide what your rate is going to be? Like, when you first started out with making beats, how do you decide when it's time to up your prices? How do you decide, all right, I'm going to do this person a favor? Right. Can you walk us through that?
I mean, well, you know, it's kind of simple. You know when to up the prices when you got a record that's popping. You know what I mean?
How much do you up it by? 20%? Do you consult with other producers?
Man, the game is so different, and I haven't, like, really been, like, trying to get placements like that, so I don't know the going rate right now. But back when I did it, you know, you just kind of knew. You know what I mean?
50K, 100K,
sometimes 15, sometimes 20. Sometimes I'll do something for free depending on who the artist is, because I know the artist is going to help me reach another, you know, level. So you got to kind of pick and choose, you know, when you want to do free shit and when you want to charge, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But like I said, if I knew the going rate, I would tell you. I don't want to say, hey, man, charge $1,500. You know, I'm way out the park. I don't know.
Who are those producers, like, not so much the biggest and the greatest and the best of all time, but for you, who are those producers that inspired you that you consider to be great?
Back then?
Just even now.
Even now, yeah. Even now it's better because you got your man Soundtrack, you know, and I met him through the Smack Pack challenges.
Okay.
Theory has it, amazing.
Uh-huh.
My man Kelsey's out of control. Oh, man, there's so many people right now that's just inspiring me heavy right now.
Mm-hmm.
All the young producers that, you know, that need to get their shine. Your man Soundtrack, he just actually signed with, not too long ago, with Ninth Wonder.
Nice.
Jambler, huh? Yeah.
And his beats are super insane, bro, I promise you.
When we played the Killer Mike Run, and we mentioned No ID during the beat, you was like, oh, okay, he landed that trap sound.
Right, right.
So who in that genre, are you a Metro Boomin fan, a Zaytoven, or are you following any of those guys?
Not really, and that's not because I don't like them, it's just because I don't really understand the energy. I'm into the boom bap. And I follow that energy. But those guys are dope, and I hear their music, and I know that they're dope at what they're doing because I can hear it. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? But I don't really follow that wave, that culture.
Okay.
But, you know, no disrespect, because it's dope, and they're definitely doing their thing. But, you know, I like my beats a little different.
That's real.
Ski Beatz.
So I'm curious about, speaking of, how do you hear music? I'm always curious about producers. I think producers are so gifted and talented when it comes to music composition and putting things together. Do you hear something in your head? Is it a melody that comes first before you sit down and start formulating the beats? Like, can you talk to me a little bit about that process? I think it's so...
Man, it's crazy because sometimes it's a melody. Sometimes, you know, I'll have a dream and I'm like, yo, like, let me get out the bed and see if I can make this. Sometimes, you know, it might be the color of her outfit that might inspire me to do something. You know, it's everything. It's everything in life, you know what I mean, that inspires me to create. Just listening, sometimes just dropping needles on old records, you know, you catch a groove like that, you know. Sometimes you just play around the keyboard, next thing you know, like, ooh, that's dope, that chord is crazy. Then you start banging something out. Mm-hmm. It's all types of ways to get inspiration, you know.
Mm. Nice. What's the longest it's taken you to make a beat, and what's the shortest?
The longest, 2 weeks, Streets is Watching, you know what I'm saying?
Streets is Watching, the Jay-Z song?
Yeah, Jay-Z, Streets is Watching. Took me 2 weeks to make the beat because I didn't know how to chop samples yet. Mm. I was still kind of looping.
Uh-huh.
So the Streets is Watching kind of definitely got my chops up, got my skills up, because it took me 2 weeks to get everything to line up because I could not get the beat on beat. Uh-huh. But when I got it on beat, it locked.
Check this out.
Streets is Watching. Check it. Check. Check. If I shoot you, I'm brainless. But if you shoot me, then you famous. What's a nigga to do when the streets is watching? Blocks keep clocking, waiting for you to break. Make your first mistake, can't ignore it. That's the fastest way to get extorted. But my time is money, and 25, I can't afford it. Beef assorted like a diver. Sharpless as you bought it. I pull a slide back and cock it. Plan to board it. You and your mans get a pass. This rhyme, you're operating off time. Y'all niggas ain't worth my shells. All y'all niggas trying to do is hurt my sales and stop trips to John McNeil.
Come on, the type man. To start a beat. TB, stop it. Stop. Stop.
Dude, I'm next to the man. Come on.
Most Def, Gene Gray, J Electronica.
Currency, though. Currency.
Currency.
Yeah.
Me and Currency. The Pilot Talk.
Me and Currency, we got a nice chemistry. We locked in really good together, man. Spitter, man, he was like real easy to work with, man. His, you know, personality is laid back. You know, he liked to smoke. So we started getting into this whole melodic world of just, you know, when I brought him up and, the senseis, and we did some of the music.
Mm-hmm.
And I loved the type of music that he loved. So it was easy for me to do that. Like the Philinists and the Luchinis. If you listen to anything that I make, it's more melodic based. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, I think that's one of the things I brought into the hip hop.
That's New your contribution.
York, the New York hip hop sound.
Yeah.
Because, you know, Primo, he was doing the hard shit.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Lord Finesse was doing the jazzy type of shit. My shit was more like chord progressions and melodies and things like that, but with the drums on top.
Absolutely.
And it was easy to produce Spitter. You know what I'm saying? Because that's what I love. I love the music.
Currency. Yeah. Mike, you want to ask?
Yeah. So, Skit, this is my first time meeting you in person. I know about you, know about your history, your discography, so all that stuff. This makes you dope. Mm-hmm. But the part of me that makes me like loving you right now is your honesty and vulnerability. Two times you've mentioned on air publicly that you weren't comfortable in doing something. You didn't know something. It was the remix.
Right.
Like, first time doing it, so I felt uncomfortable. I didn't know if he's going to like it. And then this time, you said, I didn't know how to lock up the beats. I think that's so perfect because a lot of times people freeze in those moments, right? And don't push through, and then it prohibits them from going forward. Talk to us about those moments where you didn't know and you're in front of Jay-Z and the beats just are not locking. Right. What was going through your mind, and like, how do you push through? I think that's a metaphor and a lesson for our citizens. Is like, when it gets hard and uncomfortable, don't stop.
Mm-hmm.
Oh yeah, it's like when you learn how to play an instrument. Say if I'm learning how to play the piano, and I'm practicing scales every day. You know what I'm saying? It's the same concept. You know, I couldn't chop this sample because I wasn't chopping samples at the time. I was just catching little two-bar loops. You know what I'm saying? And doing that, but that song helped me learn how to chop samples, helped me learn how to play the chords. You know what I'm saying? Helped me learn how to do that. So I pushed through it because I wanted to get better at that. And then right after Streets is Watching, more music that I started creating had more chops in it. And it kind of helped me break the ceiling of being creative. You know what
That's
I mean?
Dope.
Do you feel like you're still a student today, or do you feel comfortable calling yourself a master at this work?
I'm definitely not a master at nothing. You know what I'm saying? I'm learning every day, man.
Nothing.
You know what I'm saying? All these kids, they're killing me right now with these beats. Especially, yo, I'm telling you, Smack Pack, tune in to the Smack Pack challenges.
Okay. Yes.
Listen to what these kids are doing, man. These guys are incredible. They definitely inspire me. So, like, you know, you might think you at this level, like, yeah, I'm dope, but then you hear the level really where dope is at. You need that. As a creative, you need that.
Mm-hmm. To push you.
You know, at first you're going to be like, man, fuck that. But then you see it, you're like, you know what? Let me step it up. Let me see what I'm doing wrong. Let me recalculate and level up. And I need that. That keeps me, like, fresh, the energy. You know what I mean?
I love it, man. Ski Beatz is here. Also, DJ Eclipse hung out with us. I made him stay, y'all.
That's right.
That's right.
And he did it, man. I want to thank you, Eclipse, for staying.
Oh, man, anytime.
I would love to have you back up, man.
I'll be here next week.
Okay, cool. All right.
Oh, you know, I wanted to say one more thing, too, though. We also got, we do something every 2 months called Smack Pack Live, and I do it with the Sound Collective, and that's on 28 Broadway. And what we do is we take some of the contenders that was in the Smack Pack that I do on IG, and we put them on Twitch, and they do it live, like with the cameras in their face and everything, and that's pretty dope.
We need to do that on Sway in the Morning. I think we need to do a live Smack Pack Sway in the Morning version.
Well, it's funny you should say that,
okay.
Right?
Let's go.
Deadass, that'll be fire.
I would love to do that.
Yeah.
And I'll be judging.
Yep.
Yeah,
What am I judging?
You're judging, you know, the producers, man. You
That's
know,
right.
You got to make sure they sound good, you know?
Yeah, Tracy coming with me. All right?
Let's do it.
Oh, yeah, by the way, man, I know people, they was really anxious to hear my man Divine Drummer do his thing.
Yeah.
Shout out to DD.
Shout out to Divine Drummer. He was definitely in the building, but they would not let him up because you have to be fully vaccinated to get in this building. So he didn't dip out. He was here.
And let me say for the record, because you got your camera guy filming this, when he says they, that's not us.
That's the people with money.
This company is within the building.
Yes. Yes.
That has authority over this company that you cannot come in this building, Mike Muse, without being fully vaccinated.
Right.
But, citizens, we're celebrating Ski Beatz. Smack Pack Volume 12 is out now. Mm-hmm. I need everybody to follow Ski Beatz on his social.
Ski Beatz, SKIBEATZ. Follow me on IG. If you're a producer, the link is in the bio. You can get the pack right now. You got 15 days left to create. We got the dope verse from Stiles P. So don't play, man. This is real. You know, we got the crazy prizes. I'm giving away a Mac Mini.
Yep.
I'm giving away
a PO33.
A boom boom. You know the price. I'm giving away stuff, man. So, yo, you know, fuck with me. You know what it is. Every month we're doing this. Next month we got a dope MC, man. We got a dope MC. That's all I'm going to say.
Cool.
So tap in. Smack Pack.
Smack Pack Volume 12 also got the Dojo Sound Library. That's the Smack Pack Sound Library 1 through 12. It got Beatmakers Boutique, NPOX XS Case. It got a Loud Silas Clothing 16 Pad Box Bundle. It ain't just one thing. It's a lot of things. And then for the challenge, the panel judges is Young Guru. Bun B.
Wow.
Static Selector.
J45.
Who's incredible. Himself and myself.
Too shabby.
Not too bad. All right, Eclipse. All right. Okay.
Hey, Eclipse, we're going to get you for the next one.
I'm here.
There we go.
Okay. Eclipse, how can people follow you?
On Instagram at DJ Eclipse RSC and on Twitter at It's DJ Eclipse.
Mike Muse.
Yo, hit me up at I Am Mike Muse, MUSSME on Instagram and Twitter. Check out the Mike Muse Show this Saturday, 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on Urban View Channel 126. And happy anniversary to the Noops Sigma chapter of Cowboy Cypher.
100 year anniversary. Hey. Mike Muse will be hosting a gala tomorrow.
Yes.
All right.
And a picnic.
And
not
a picnic.
Not everybody's invited unless you. Kappa. A Kappa.
Okay. Pretty Boy Nation.
Yo, stand up, baby.
Corporate gang. All right, Tracy, how can they find you?
Yo, citizens, it's been a really beautiful week with y'all. Hit me up on Twitter, Instagram, at HTracyG, ITSTRACYG.
All right, I'm at Real Sway across the board. Good to be back.
Woo!
We'll be back Monday. We got Mashonda's going to come by Monday. She got some new music.
Nice.
All right. And this beautiful woman.
I love her.
A very talented creative.
Yes, and really good at family blending.
This is true. I'm going to have to bring my daughter up here and see if it works. On that note, citizens, Ski Beatz, thank you for coming. All right, we have nothing left to say.